And our word for today on this Wednesday of the 13th week in Ordinary Time, this Wednesday, July the 5th, our word for today is cry, our reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 21. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Isaac grew, and on the day of the child's weaning, Abraham held a great feast. Sarah noticed the son whom Hagar, the Egyptian, had born to Abraham playing with her son Isaac. So she demanded of Abraham, "Drive out that slave and her son. No son of that slave is going to share the inheritance with my son Isaac." Abraham was greatly distressed, especially on the account of his son Ishmael. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed about the boy or about your slave woman. Heed the demands of Sarah, no matter what she is asking of you. For it is through Isaac that descendants shall bear your name. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a great nation of him also, since he too is your offspring." Early the next morning, Abraham got some bread and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. Then, placing the child on her back, he sent her away. As she roamed aimlessly in the wilderness of Beersheba, the water in the skin was used up. So she put the child down under a shrub and then went and sat down opposite him, about a bow shot away. For she said to herself, "Let me not watch to see the child die." As she sat opposite Ishmael, he began to cry. God heard the boy's cry, and God's messenger called to Hagar from heaven. "What is the matter, Hagar?" "Don't be afraid. God has heard the boy's cry and is in this plight of his. Arise, lift up the boy, and hold him by the hand, for I will make of him a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water, and then let the boy drink. God was with the boy as he grew up. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm 34, "The Lord hears the cry of the poor." When the poor one called out, the Lord heard, and from all of his distress he saved him. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for naught is lacking to those who fear him. The great grow poor and hungry, but those who seek the Lord want for no good thing. Come, children, hear me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Which of you desires life and takes delight in prosperous days?
Our gospel acclamation from James. Alleluia, alleluia. The Father willed to give us birth by the word of truth, that we may be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus came to the territory of the Gadarenes, two demoniacs who were coming from the tombs met him. They were so savage that no one could travel by that road. They cried out, "What have you to do with us, Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before the appointed time?" Some distance away, a herd of many swine was feeding. The demons pleaded with him, "If you drive us out, send us into the herd of swine." And he said to them, "Go then." And they came out and entered the swine, and the whole herd rushed down the steep bank into the sea, where they drowned. The swineherds ran away, and when they came to the town, they reported everything, including what had happened to the demoniacs. Therefore, the whole town came out to meet Jesus, and when they saw him, they begged him to leave their district.
And our word for today is cry. Cry, our word for today. We begin first, as is our custom, with our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading. These he shared at Santa Marta on April the 11th, 2014. We too are tempted. We too are objects of the demon's attacks. For the spirit of evil does not want us to become holy. It does not want us to bear witness to Christ. It does not want us to be disciples of Christ. What does the spirit of evil do to snatch us away from Jesus' path through temptation? The devil's temptations have three main characteristics. Again, the devil's temptations have three main characteristics, and we have to be aware of them in order to not fall into this trap. First, the temptation begins with subtlety, but then it grows and increasingly grows stronger. Then it infects someone. It spreads to another and seeks to take root in the community. Finally, to calm the soul, it seeks to justify itself. In short, it grows, spreads, and justifies itself. Again, in short, it grows, spreads, and justifies itself. We are all tempted because our spiritual life, our Christian life, is a battle. This comes from the fact that the devil does not want us to become holy. He does not want us to follow Jesus. Of course, one of you will say, "But Father, you are so old-fashioned, speaking about the devil in the 21st century. Watch out. The devil exists. The devil exists even in the 21st century. And we must not be naive. We must learn from the gospel how to battle against him." We must learn from the gospel how to battle against him, Pope Francis says. Boy, this is kind of laying out very, very clearly how the spiritual attack takes place. First, it grows in us, then it spreads, and then it justifies itself. And those are the marks, and we can see them. I can see them in my own life, in the areas of my own struggle. They begin first as a very kind of tepid way of the evil one coming and introducing a thought, an idea. And because I've not risen up to stop that thing, to speak against that thing, to end that thing, to speak forward the name of Jesus, to call on the help of Our Lady, then that thing is allowed to come in and make a home in me. And then what does it do? It spreads. And then finally, either you have to turn against that thing, resist the evil one, and he will flee, the scripture says, or you have to begin to justify the behavior, why it's okay. Instead of doing the thing that the Lord asks us to do, to cry out to him that we might find relief. But first, it's required of us that we react, that we cry out in desperate situations, that we do in a spiritual way what Ishmael did by nature. He was crying out. Why? Because he was in a desperate situation. He was just a young boy and he was hungry. He wasn't that young a boy, by the way. This is not a baby. I mean, we're talking about Ishmael was running around when Isaac was a baby. So this is not a mother watching her infant die. This is a mother watching her young son die of starvation. She separates herself, the scripture says, by a bow's length away. So how far it would take to shoot an arrow into the air, she moves herself from there so that she doesn't have to encounter this in close up, because there's nothing that she can do for Ishmael. You know, and Sarah, God bless her, but Sarah is the one who brought this whole thing about. By her own suggestion, by her own lack of faith, she says, "Look, I'm not getting pregnant, so you take Hagar, you take the slave woman, and you have a child with her." And I'm sure when Hagar was pregnant and Ishmael was born, Sarah probably celebrated that thing, that Abraham had a son, and now the promise that God had made him could go forward. But her lack of faith caused this thing to come into place. And when God had his way, as he was going to have from the very beginning, when God's plan came to fruition, she just absolutely rejected the thing that she herself had brought into existence. You know, and we have to be careful. We come to a place from a place, and the things we did along the way, we also have to own. We also have to acknowledge. And in some ways, we need to acknowledge that those things can be used for good by God. Now, I don't know the mind of God. I can't say what his perfect plan was for Ishmael and Isaac, but we can imagine the difference that it would have made if Ishmael and Isaac had been allowed to grow up together, to live together, to commune together, if Hagar and Sarah had been civil with one another, because what we see in the scriptures going forward from that is constant conflict between the offspring of Ishmael and the offspring of Isaac. So we can learn in our own lives that what we need to do is make peace with our past and pray for a better future. What does, one of the definitions of forgiveness is to let go of the idea of a better past. We cannot change the past. We cry out to God for forgiveness for our sins, and we ask that we be released from them. But we don't deny them. We don't try to run from them. nor do we try to imagine that it might turn out better. It's not going to turn out better. The past is the past. And so we cry out to the Lord for his mercy. We cry out in the midst of our desperation, as Ishmael did, and we see clearly that he was heard. As she sat opposite, she being Hagar, he began to cry. Ishmael began to cry. God heard the boy's cry, and God's messenger called to Hagar from heaven, "What is the matter, Hagar? Don't be afraid. God has heard the boy's cry in this plight of his. Arise, lift up the boy, and hold him by the hand, for I will make of him a great nation." The Lord takes all of the devastating results, even of our own bad decisions, even of our own evil decisions, even of our own sin. He takes it all if we are willing to give it to him. And he works out a better plan for us as we cry out to him. Cry, our word for today.